ask Brother Wayne if you would, bless her offering.
Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, again for the day. Thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord, for another day to be back in thy house. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the beautiful day that you blessed us with. Thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord, for watching over us throughout the week. Lord, taking care of us, bringing us back, Lord, again tonight. Lord, we ask you, Heavenly Father, Lord, that you'll bless this offering. Bless those who have it to give, Lord. We just ask you, Lord, to pour a double portion upon the one that does, Lord, I pray. Lord, continue to be those that sick and afflicted. Ask you, Lord, that you'll just touch them and strengthen them. Lord, give us a good service, Lord. I pray in every will and way and everything is done. We'll give you the praise and honor and glory for it all. We ask these things in your precious name we pray. Amen.
Good evening. Good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Thank the Lord for all his many blessings. God's been good to us, ain't he? God's been good to us, ain't he? Amen. Amen. He sure has. No matter what's going on in our life, good or bad or indifferent, we got to say we're blessed. Amen. We're blessed. Blessed. And we, no matter what's going on in our life, we can say that God's still good. He's merciful to us. And he's blessed us beyond measure. Thank the Lord for the day, the beautiful day the Lord's blessed us with, and thank him for that. And I thank him for the rain. I know most of us probably would say, I wish this rain would end, but did you notice how green everything got after... Notice my seed started germinating after the rain. The grass seed, potato seed, and everything that was in the ground began to begin to start germinating. So it takes the rain, and it takes the storms to see life a lot of times and see growth. And so, and we can look at that in a spiritual sense as well, couldn't we? But I think of that song as we sung, Never Grow Old. Growing up, that song was, I never understood that song. And thinking, well, what, you know, never grow old. But as we get older, things happen, don't they? Our body starts, basically, we started dying the day we was born. And the older we get, the more we go through. And I want to say this, that glorified body's looking better all the time. And that song has more meaning to me now than it ever has. Amen. I'm excited to get out of this, ain't you? I'm excited to put on that glorified body. I'm excited to have an incorruptible body. Incorruptible means it'll never decay, never grow old, right? And an immortal body will never die. That's all we've known in this body, is it gets sick and it dies eventually. But we're going to have a brand new body. And you've heard me say many a time, the best part of that body, it's not that it won't be sick again. Not in my, and this is the way, this is Kevin speaking. I'm not excited as much about not having cancer again and no more ailments and aches and pains. But that body will never sin again. This gets in my way, don't it, you? This hinders me from serving God. This hinders me from doing the will of God sometimes. And it's not God's fault, it's my fault. But it's this old flesh I have to contend with every day. But one day I'll get up in heaven and I won't have to worry about contending with this old flesh. The devil won't be there. Amen. We can stop right now and shout it out the rest of the service. The devil won't be there. Amen. But Jesus is the light of that city. Amen. And I'm thankful that we'll be there one day after a while. Let's remember Ben Brackens, his family. Ben went home to be with the Lord Monday morning around 2 something. And let's remember his family. I know by Ben's testimony, he's not hurting no more. He's with the Lord. To be absent from this body, willing to rather to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. And he's suffered for the last several years. How many years has it been, Darlene? He's 6 years that he battled. And his battle was hard. It was very painful, the cancer he had. And he wasn't just painful just in the last few weeks. I mean, he's been in pain for years. But his battle's over now. And let's pray for his family, Lord, to just strengthen them and give them the grace that they stand in need of his services. They want to have visitation, I believe, 5 to 7, is it, at Valley Funeral Home to Friday evening, and the service at 7 or at Valley Funeral Home. So let's remember that and be praying for that family. Let's remember Herman. Herman's doing good. He's going to get to go home, Lord willing, if everything goes well, Friday. So let's remember him. Remember Ruby Ledford. Ruby Ledford got to go home a few days ago. She's doing better. Just keep her in your prayers. Let's remember Allison Tittle. She's still having seizures and had one today. And I can't imagine how that is. I've not had a seizure, but they keep having them every day, and sometimes multiple ones a day. And let's pray for her and pray for Mom and Dad too, because it's, you feel helpless when you see your child going through that and can't do nothing to stop it. And Let's pray for them. And Bill Langerfeld had his surgery, and he's waiting on the test, their biopsy there, so they've done. So let's pray for him, the Lord to give him strength. And Shirley, she has a kidney stone, so let's remember Bill's wife, Shirley. So those of you who've had kidney stones, I've only had one. Thought I was going to die. Sure did. So make that right, Bob. It sure is. If you've never had one, when you have one, you'll know it. You will. And so those of you who've had kidney stones, you know how to pray for Miss Shirley Langerfeld. So keep her in your prayers. Let's see here. Russell Cox is still out in the Irwin Hospital. So let's keep him in our prayers. Russell's having a hard time with his breathing and just a lot of things going on there. So remember him. I'd like to remember Corbin having some issues with his heart, just heart rate, blood pressure, getting it all under control, not doing well with medicine. Medicine is making him dizzy. Thought he was going to pass out yesterday morning, scared me to death. So anyway, but they've changed the medicine. Just pray that they can figure out what's going on and maybe get this medicine under control. Anytime you take heart medication, it makes you feel bad for a while. But anyway, just remember him in prayer, if you don't mind. And let's continue to remember Debbie Phillips in prayer. She goes to the doctor there this week about her back, and I believe it is. And so it's our, maybe in another couple weeks, I believe it is, ain't it? So let's remember her in prayer. Let's see here. Got a lot of sickness in our church, as you can tell. All right, let's remember Randy Trivett in prayer, yes. Roger Ambrose, just remember him. All right.
Remember Lisa Whitehead.
Lisa Whitehead, yes, remember. All right, just remember Lisa Whitehead. That's her cousin. She was here in the revival and testified there. Bob says she's back in the hospital. Let's remember her.
Remember Phyllis Hewitt.
Let's remember Phyllis. Remember Justin, yes. Remember that. Remember that. Let's remember that. How's Harper? Have you heard an update on Harper?
She's doing okay. She's taking time to antibiotics, but she's doing okay.
All right. Let's continue to remember baby Harper.
Today for his fourth chemo treatment, his third treatment, really good to tell you on the evening.
Yes. Much to be in prayer about, ain't it?
Remember me and my family.
All right.
Pray. Y'all need so much guidance. My children are not in church, but my granddaughter's the only one that I can get to go with and to come with me. And remember my kid's bad. He's trying to clean himself up. And he needs the Lord in his life.
Man.
He knows God, but he's strange. He needs the Lord to pray for him.
All right, just remember that. Unspoken request, lift the hand. Let's all Ken and Will come around the altar. Hey, Mary Beth. She's a little girl. Okay, Delancey's gonna be. He's a little girl here. Okay, all right. There we go. Anybody got a song or a testimony? Or? Amen. Yes. Amen. All right. Turn with us in Psalms 19. Verse 14, scripture's been on my mind today, but it's been praying, Lord, to just settle us somewhat. You'd have us to preach tonight and to read, and as I've said before, I'm very careful of what the Lord would have us to read and preach on, because it's God knows exactly what we need every day and for the hour, and God sure doesn't need my help, man, but we need his help. And I think sometimes as preachers, if we ain't careful, we'll try to help the Lord. We'll try to pick out something. And I can't do that, because I know that God knows exactly what we need. He knows what you're going through. He knows what I'm going through. And he knows the very scriptures, the very words that we need. And so I'm very careful. You pray for us tonight as we just be led by the Lord. Psalms 19, verse 14, stand with us tonight for the verse, reading of God's word. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Heavenly Father, we love you tonight, and we thank you that, God, just for your word. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do. And I just pray, God, that you'd help us tonight, and you'd use us for your glory and your honor. Lord, we know tonight, God, within ourselves, God, we can't do anything. And we just pray, Lord, that you just enable us tonight. And God, just give us exactly what we stand in need of. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Begin to think about the word meditate. And that word meditate means to dwell on anything in thought, to contemplate, to study. Goes on, but that's the gist of it. To dwell on anything in thought, to contemplate or to study upon it. And I was thinking of this scripture today, and where the psalmist says, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And that I believe in every child of God's heart, and we want to please the Lord, and we want to be acceptable unto the Lord. And as I said earlier, this flesh hinders me a lot of times. Flesh, I let it get in the way, don't we? The devil don't have no more power over us than we give him, so we can't really blame the devil for our actions. We have to blame ourselves. Man, the devil made me do it is not a excuse that'll stand. But we decide what we're going to do. We make up our mind whether we're going to give in to the temptation or whether we're going to overcome the temptation. I've related to this scripture a lot in James 1. A man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. And it goes on to say that when it's conceived, when you give in to the sin, right? You can't really help being tempted, but you can help acting upon the temptation, right? It says, when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed, then when lust hath conceived, what that means is when you give in to whatever it is, it bringeth forth sin, and sin when it's finished, it bringeth forth death. But how that a lot of it starts in our mind, don't it? You've heard me say your mind's a big place. And what you feed your mind and what you dwell on, what you meditate, you're going to, in other words, act upon it. When someone is dwelling on something, it is basically directing you, right? We can dwell on the negative things in life, and we can dwell on the bad things in life. Let me say this. There's a lot of folks tonight that are dwelling on the wrong things, evil things. And I believe the result of those dwelling upon those evil thoughts and evil things, a lot of people, and we read in the Word of God where people were demon-possessed. I believe there's still people in this world that are demon-possessed because they have dwelt and they have meditated upon the evil so long they are full of it. But I'm glad that nothing is stronger than the power of God. You look about the man named Legion. He had a name Legion because he had many devils in him. But when Jesus rebuked those evil spirits out of him, they went into the swine, and the swine ran off the cliff there, you know, and how they bid him to cast them out into the swine, and they did. And so, but that man named Legion, when the Lord got through with him, he was clothed in his right mind. He was dwelling in tombs, and he was a wild man. He was a mad man. He was full of evil. But the Lord delivered him from all that, didn't he? And so he was clothed and in his right mind, and he wanted to follow Jesus, didn't he? The Lord changed his heart, and the Lord changed his mind. So and I was thinking today is, let the words of my mouth, and this ought to be every child of God's desire, that our words be pleasing unto God. Amen. The meditation of our heart. The Bible says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. You've heard me speak before. How the Bible says, when a man seems to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, this man's religion in vain. So it doesn't matter what you claim to be. Friend, it's going to come out of your mouth what's in your heart. And four-letter words and curse words, and people say, I've heard people say, well, this is not a curse word, and this is, the Bible speaks of them as idle words, right? If it ain't edifying God, really there's no need to say it, are there? But you think about things that the Bible tells us, the little foxes spoil the vine, and I believe the words of our mouth can spoil the vine sometimes. He can hurt your influence, what you talk about, what you maybe get caught up in the wrong crowd, telling dirty jokes, laughing at dirty jokes, and you say that wasn't so bad or whatever, but we bear the image of Jesus Christ, and people knows where you go to church, don't they? Right? They know where you go to church. So you're not only bearing reproach upon yourself but others around you, and your church, your family, right? Your natural family and your church family. Amen. So it's very important that we know and that we be careful of the words of our mouth, that we speak no guile, and that we walk circumspectly, amen, not as fools but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil, the Bible says. Walking circumspectly is considering ever consequent and circumstances behind before we act upon it. Me and Tiffany talked about this several times, how we living in a generation where everybody is thinking about now, they're not thinking about the long term. What this decision will basically affect long term. People don't think that way. People don't think, well, what if I was to do this? How's it going to affect my children? How's it going to affect my spouse, my marriage? How's it going to affect my church? But people are so very quick to act upon things without thinking about the circumstances and the consequences. That's why the Bible tells us Christians to walk circumspectly. Not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Amen. So meditation, to dwell upon it, to study upon it. And I was thinking about in Psalms 19:11, says, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee." And when we dwell upon the word of God, amen. Psalms 1, there's plenty of good meditation verses in Psalms, ain't there? "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doeth he meditate day and night." What does it go on to say about that person that meditates upon the Lord? Day and night. "He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper." You ever wonder sometimes, you say, well, it seems like every time whatever I touch, it seems like it falls to pieces. Seems like the harder I try, the worse it gets. And seems like that whatever I try to do, it just don't amount to anything. I've got a good start, but it just don't amount to anything. But when we let God direct our steps, and the steps of a good man is ordered by the Lord, the Bible says. Amen? And so when we allow God to direct us instead of us trying to direct God, I believe that's the problem a lot of times. We're trying to direct God in our life instead of allowing God to direct our lives in the way He should have us to do. Amen? We've got our agenda, and we've got our ways we want to do, and we've got our life the way we want it, and we want God to be where we want Him to be on the days we want Him to be there. And but then any other time, we've got it figured out sometimes. Don't we act that way? We may never say that, but we act as if, God, I need you on these days, but the rest of the days, Lord, I've got it. But we need Him all the time, and we need Him to direct our paths. And when we delight in the law of God, and we delight and meditate upon the Word of God, because the Word of God is our light, ain't it? Lamp unto our feet and a light unto our paths. Amen? That's the only direction you've got in this world is the Word of God. Amen? The world, they've got ideas and they've got opinions and they've got ways. But it's not the ways of God. There's dead-end ways. There's dead-end streets in the ways of the world, aren't they? But the Lord's the only way. But now, I was thinking about people that have allowed God and allowed the Word of God to penetrate their heart in directing their lives. Moses was dead. Joshua chapter number 1. Go with me there. Joshua chapter number 1. Moses was dead. God spoke to Joshua and he said, "Moses, my servant, is dead, but Joshua, I want you to..." And listen, the children of Israel hadn't made it to Canaan land yet. But he said, "I want you to lead my people." And now that was a great, great task to lead of these people, this rebellious generation, this rebellious people that was continually, just continually rebelling and going... had their own weaknesses and temptations. Idol worship was very, very prevalent, wasn't it? But Joshua here, the Lord said, and you can read all of it there, but verse number 6, "Be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shall that divide for an inheritance of the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest." This book of the law, now listen,
shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do it, do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Now let me say this. We think about success is in riches. We think success is in materialistic things, monetary success. But truly, friend, a Christian is successful when we deny ourselves and take up our cross and follow Jesus. And it takes a denying every day, don't it? But we'll become more successful if we put our little ideas and opinions behind us and follow God and God's way and God's word. It's an old book, but it still applies to everything you're facing today. Amen. You know what he said about it? It's what God said. He said, the grass withereth and the flower fadeth, but the word of God abideth forever. And surely man is as grass. Right? We are, the Bible says. We're as grass. But the word of God abideth forever. How many times have you ever heard Baldy Bennett say, the Word of God will stand when the world's on fire? Yes, it will. But he told him there, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate. So he told him to meditate. And you know why he told him that? Because in that meditation, the dwelling upon the Word of God and dwelling upon the law of God was direction for what he needed to lead his people, to lead God's people. And in order for me to preach, in order for me to pastor, I have to be led by the Word of God. I have to dwell upon the Word of God. Study to show thyself approved, Paul told Timothy, right? And in order for me to help you, I've got to be helped myself. Right? And so Joshua had to be helped from the Lord to help God's people. So in order for you to help somebody, you say, well, I'm not a preacher, or I'm not a leader of the church. But if you're saved, God wants you to help people. And how can you help them if you're not dwelling upon the Word of God? Now, you say, well, it's hard to pray all the time, and it's hard to think about the Bible all the time. But that's not what it's saying. It's in your heart. Dwelling on it, right? Dwelling on it. Now, I usually have a song on my heart about every day. I've usually got scripture on my heart every day. And it's very important. And if I ain't careful sometimes, I can get busy and I can let that clutter, that busyness, or maybe a problem that's going on that I'm worried about or I'm concerned about, I can let that clutter what I was dwelling on this morning. Right? I can let bad situations drown out the good seed of God and the good word of God that I thought about. That's why it's important to start your day out in prayer and read God's word. And it don't matter if it, however long it is or how short it is, just spend time with the Lord and make good of the time. Don't just go in a repetitious way, just say you've done it and go on. But get some manna from heaven, because God's got manna for his children every day, don't he? Every morning. It got just like that there's a breakfast every morning. God's got some manna for you every morning, don't he? But it's up to you if you're going to eat it or not. And if we don't eat the good word of God, and if we don't be meditate upon the word of God, we're going to be malnourished, and the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart won't be pleasing unto God. I promise you. When you get out of God's word and you get off your knees, the meditation of your heart and the words of your mouth will not be pleasing unto God. This here God didn't save. He saved your soul. That's why that you have to have this old flesh under subjection every day. That's why that you have to pray to keep it under subjection. That's why that you have to read God's word to keep this under subjection. I'm not above it. You ain't above it. No matter how long you've been saved, no matter what your calling is, whether you're a preacher, deacon, lay member, whatever you are, you've still got to keep this thing under subjection. Amen. Look at David. David was a man after God's own heart. He wanted to follow God, didn't he? He wanted God to bless him. God blessed him in mighty ways. He done the unthinkable. When a little shepherd boy slayed a giant named Goliath. But one day, David got within himself. David wasn't dwelling and meditating upon the things of God and upon God's ways like he should have. So he chose to stay home from battle that day. Amen. You ever remember your mom and daddy or maybe somebody at school say, be where you need to be. If you be where you're supposed to be, you won't get in trouble. Well, that goes for everybody of every age, even of an adult. Amen. You be where you're supposed to be and you won't wind up in a lot of shape and situations you'd be in. David didn't go to battle. So he was up on the housetop and back in those days, they had porches and or what have you up on the housetops, right? And it said above, and he looked down, and he saw Bathsheba over there bathing. And he began to lust after her. And then that lust conceived, he gave in to that lust, right? And from that day on, things went downhill a spiral very quickly, didn't it? He committed adultery, fornication, and she conceived a child, and he thought he had it covered up, but nobody knowed about it. But Nathan the prophet come to him and basically said, "Thou art the man, David." And he knew then that nothing was hid from God. You can hide from man, but you ain't going to hide from God. The Bible says, be sure your sins will find you out. Right? So it's very important. You say, why is it so important to meditate upon the Word of God, that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart be acceptable unto God? Because if we ain't careful, we can make a mess of things. David was in a mess. I mean, before Nathan the prophet came to him and told him, thou art the man, he had went and called Bathsheba's husband Uriah from the battle and tried to make him drunk and make him go home to lay with his wife to make it look like it was his child. But that didn't work. Uriah laid at the king's door, and he said, how can I go home and eat and drink and lie with my wife when my brethren's out there on the battlefield? He wouldn't do it. And so he laid there until he got orders to go back to battle. So plan A didn't work, so plan B was write a letter, send it to Joab by the hand of Uriah himself. So he handed him his own death wish. He told David, wrote to Joab, you put Uriah on the hottest part of the battle, on the front lines. And that way, the plan was for him to be killed. And Uriah took that letter, handed it to Joab, not knowing. That shows his faithfulness. He didn't open that letter. He didn't open it. He handed it to him, not knowing what it was. Said the king, said, give that to you, Joab. And it was on his own death wish. And then here it was. He was dead. He died in the hottest part of the battle. David thought, got that sewed up. Nobody knows about it. Wrong. God sent Nathan, the prophet. He said, what can I do for you? He said, well, I'm going to tell you a little something. He said, there was a poor man, and he had a little old ewe lamb, and it was like a family member to him. And all they took care of it, and they loved that lamb. But one day, said the king, there he had company, and the king owned thousands of, animals and lambs. And the king had company one day. Instead of the king getting one of his out of his own flock, he took that poor man's lamb, and he killed it and fed it to his company. Oh, David got mad, and he said, "That man will pay." Nathan said, "Thou art the man." And when he said it, I believe he pointed at him. I really do. I believe he pointed at him and said, "Thou art the man." You know what? David knew then there's nothing hid from God. So David prayed, and he said, "Lord, in Psalms 51, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me." So he realized what he had done, and he owned it. When you do wrong, own it. Own up to it. Be honest with yourself, honest with God, own it. I've had this conversation with many people. They're trying to cover it up, blame it on somebody else. I've sat in places and they're looking at me through jail cells and trying to give an excuse. Still yet, being arrested and innocent, saying, "Well, I'm innocent. And it ain't up to me to judge them. But I've said this, you and God know the truth. And if you're hiding something, if you're trying to run from something, it's going to catch you. The truth is going to catch you. It always will. So own it. So when you mess up, own it. Let me say about marriages. You know what hurts a marriage when husband and wife does not admit the wrongdoings. When both sides are not owning it and saying, "Hey, I messed up. I shouldn't have done this, or I shouldn't have said this. I shouldn't have went about this the way I did," or whatever. Own it. Be transparent with one another. Your relationship with God is just the way your marriage is. You got to be transparent with yourself, because listen, God already knows. Amen. You're not hiding a thing from God. He knows the intents of your heart. The intent. He knows what you're thinking. I mentioned this the other day. When Jesus, a lot of places, he knew what they were thinking. He perceived what they were thinking. He knew, because he knows the intents of her heart. I mean, they were amazed a lot of times. You know what I'm talking about. In the four accounts, I've stopped saying four gospels because there's only one gospel, ain't there? Amen? There's just four accounts of the gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, right? So, but in those four accounts, there's times that he knew what they were thinking. And he knows what you're thinking. He knows your intentions. He knows your agenda. Right? He knows your plan. He knows that maybe you're trying to do this to get this or whatever. God ain't going to bless all that, is he? But when we do things out of the pureness of our heart, and I think about what Paul told Timothy there. I want to read this here, and I'm coming to a close here in just a moment. But he told Timothy, "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity." That's 1 Timothy 4:12. That'd be good for you to write that down. 1 Timothy 4:12. "Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation to doctrine. What is that? That's the Word of God, infallible Word of God. He said this here, neglect not the gift that is in thee, which is given thee by prophecy with the laying on hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things. There's that word meditate. Give thyself wholly to them that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Take heed to yourself. Sammy Allen, man of God, he's dead and gone now, but he said, I've been saved, I can't remember now how many years, 40, 50 years, he said, I still don't trust myself. Take heed to thyself. Be careful for nothing. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. So, when you take heed to yourself, you save yourself from a lot of trouble. Amen? Save yourself from a lot of trouble. It would say, save thyself. Now, it ain't talking about salvation there, right? That's saving yourself, keeping yourself from a lot of things this old flesh will get you into. Have you ever found yourself in a mess? And those messes were self-inflicted messes. Man, if you thought, if I could go back and redo it again, I'd do things a whole lot differently. Right? But if you find yourself in chastisement more than you are enjoying the good things of God, chances are the meditation of the words of your mouth and the meditation of your heart is not acceptable unto God. Amen. If we dwell and meditate upon the Word of God and keep our self focused upon the will of God in our life, yes, we're still going to mess up. But it's not going to be just like we're living in chastisement all the time. I mean, if you're truly saved, the Lord's going to chasten you, right? You've heard me preach on that many times. But your life, your Christian life, does not have to be a life of chastisement. I mean, growing up, I got whoopings all the time. But there's a day I growed up. And I said, hey, if I start listening, I won't get whooped no more. Right? Same way in your Christian life. If you don't want to get a whooping spiritually no more as much or whatever, then hey, quit doing the same things. Right? But let the meditation, the words of our mouth. The Bible says to have our lips seasoned with salt. We need to be seasoned with salt. And that's that salt, that substance which is from the Lord. Let the Holy Spirit of God, because if we're truly say, we're walking in the Spirit, right? And if we're walking in the Spirit of God's leading us, and the Spirit of God has given us the words to say, right? That's the only way we can help ourselves and help others. Is, you know, I've seen people, your tongue can get you in a world of mess. It really can. The Bible tells us that it's full of deadly poison. It's a little member, but how great a little, what does it say here? It talks about how we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, although they be so great, are driven fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small ham, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold how great a matter a little fire kindleth. That can hurt your witness. You get wrapped up in gossip. And you tell somebody, when I ain't supposed to tell you this, but I'm going to tell you. And then whoever you tell that, they go ahead and drag and tell somebody and tag your name onto it. Amen. People can lose confidence in you if they've told you something in confidence. If somebody says, hey, I'm going to tell you something in confidence, don't tell nobody. Listen, you need to be responsible and say, hey, my word's my bond, right? And take that seriously. Or, well, I don't know if it's true, but so-and-so said, and you repeat what so-and-so said that you don't know what's true, and then the next person's going to say, well, I don't know if it's true, but then they'll tag your name. They told me, right? That can hurt your influence, hurt your witness, right? Your tongue. Getting mad. Your tongue getting you in trouble, can't it? It says, the tongue is a fire, the world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and set on fire the course of nature and set on fire of hell. A kind of beast and birds and serpents of the things of the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind. But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, but of deadly poison. So, we need to be careful, don't we? That little song, oh, be careful, little tongue, what you say. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little tongue, what you say. So I pray tonight that we've been challenged, that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart is acceptable unto God. It ain't for me and you to say it's acceptable, but it's what the Holy Ghost is already saying, setting His approval upon our life. Amen. We justify ourselves, but that don't mean it's okay. You can justify your actions. You can justify what you say. You can justify what you do. You can justify what you listen to, what you watch all day long. That still don't make it right. There's only one justifier, and that's God. Amen. And the Holy Spirit of God lets us know what's right and what's wrong. Man, if you don't feel right about it, don't do it. Right? Don't do it. You say something and you can't take it back. You can say I'm sorry all day long, but what's said, said, right? But I mean, apologizing is good, don't get me wrong. But think about it before you say it, amen? Think about the consequences. That's the message tonight. Heavenly Father, we love you tonight and we thank you, God, for your word. And I pray, Lord, that you just help us all to help us, Lord, to be acceptable, Lord. Everything we do, the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart, to be acceptable, Lord. Because, God, when those two things are in check, Lord, when we dwell upon you, we'll bear the fruit of the Spirit. And the world needs to see you in our life, not us. They don't need to see our fleshly side. They need to see you. And God, they need to see something that they'll desire. They'll want to know, because God, Lord, they don't want to. If they see the flesh, they won't want that, because they're already living in sin. They're already living in that life. But Lord, when they see something they don't have, they'll want what we've got. And that's the fruit of the Spirit. Lord, we love you and we thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.